Hi, welcome. My name is Noah Marelli, and today I'm going to present a joint work with Keren Sandor-Hillel, Roy Schwartz, and Tigran Tonoyan on fault-tolerant MaxCut. This is the plan for today. I will start with some background, define the problem, proceed by showing the remaining results, and then present some of the core ideas and tools that we used to achieve the results. I said that I will talk about fault-tolerant MaxCut, so let's start with understanding what fault tolerance is. So in the fault tolerance setting, we represent a network of computers by a graph. Every computer is represented by a vertex, and every link between two computers is represented by an edge. Given an optimization problem on graph, the goal is to find a solution that is good even if part of the graph fails. Specifically, in this work, we deal with the failure of vertices. Note that when a vertex fails, it is removed from the graph along with all its adjacent edges. In general, when dealing with faults, we would like the solution to be good, no matter which vertices fail. We like to think about this scenario as we have a malicious adversary that can remove a bounded number of vertices from the graph, while our goal is to design an algorithm that outputs a solution that will be good after the adversary. Fault tolerance has been studied for many problems, such as BFS, spanners, single source reachability, connected dominating set, and many more. And in this work, we initiated the study of fault tolerant MaxCut. So let's start with a simple example. Just a reminder, in the classic MaxCut problem, our goal is to choose a cut, which is a subset of vertices, such that the number of edges that have exactly one endpoint in the cut is maximal. In this graph, a possible MaxCut is V1. However, this is not a good fault-tolerant MaxCut, since when V1 fails, there are no edges that cross the cut. A better cut can be achieved by taking V2 and V5 to the other side of the cut. In this cut, we still have 4 crossing edges, but now, no matter which vertex fails, there are at least 2 edges that cross the cut, as you can see here. Intuitively, this is our goal. We want to find a cut that has many crossing edges for every vertex that is removed. In order to define the problem formally, let's start with some graph notations. We deal with edge-weighted graphs so that every edge has a non-negative weight. We denote the number of vertices by n and the number of edges by m. We denote the degree of a vertex v by dv, which is the total weight of edges that touch V. A cut is just a subset of vertices, but we like to think about the cut as taking all the vertices that are in the cut to one side of the graph. Usually, what interests us in a cut is the edges that cross it, and we denote this set by delta S. We denote the size of the cut S by CS, which is the sum of weights of the edges that cross the cut. We denote the crossing degree of V by dsv, which is the total weight of crossing edges that touches V, and denote by g minus V the graph G after the vertex V fails. In the MaxCut problem, we get a weighted graph as input, and the goal is to find a cut with maximal size. MaxCut is one of Karp's NP-complete problem, which means that as long as P is not equal NP, one cannot find an optimal solution in polynomial time. However, we know how to approximate the problem. Gomez and Williamson showed in 1995 how to approximate MaxCut within an approximation ratio of roughly 0.8786. And we didn't know this ratio but by alpha GW. Later, Hott et al. Showed that this is the best approximation ratio that one can achieve, assuming the unique games conjecture. In fault-tolerant MaxCut, we have two entities. We have the algorithm that receives a graph as an input, can use randomness, and outputs a cut. We also have the malicious adversary that chooses a bounded number of vertices to fail and desires to minimize the size of the cut. The goal of the algorithm is to maximize the size of the cut after the adversary acts. More specifically, we consider two types of adversaries. The adaptive adversary, who knows everything. He knows the graph, he knows how the algorithm works, and he also knows the coin tosses that the algorithm uses. Altogether, the adversary knows the cut, and given the cut, he has to decide which vertices to remove. In addition, we consider the oblivious adversary. The oblivious adversary knows the graph, knows the algorithm, but doesn't know the random coin tosses. So the oblivious adversary doesn't know exactly what is the cut, but he knows what is the probability for every cut to be chosen. In other words, the adversary gets as input a distribution over cuts, and given this distribution, he has to choose which vertices to remove. Only after the adversary chooses which vertices to fail, we sample a cut from the distribution. And our goal in this scenario is to maximize the expected size of the cut after fail. And this is the formal definition. So for the adaptive adversary and the single fault, we want to find a cut that maximizes the FT value, which is the minimal size of the cut over all possible failures. For the oblivious adversary and the single fault, we want to find a distribution that maximizes the FT value, which is the minimum expected size of the cut over all possible failures. For k-faults, we have similar definitions. And this is our results. So for the adaptive adversary, we present a polynomial time 0.878 approximation that works on unweighted graphs and every constant number of faults. In addition, we show that one cannot approximate the problem within a factor greater than 0.8786, which is the constant of Gomez and Williamson, assuming the unique games conjecture, which is close to our approximation. For the oblivious adversary, we present a polynomial time, alpha GW approximation, on weighted graphs and for every constant number of faults. Here, we also show hardness of alpha GW, assuming the unique game conjecture, and assuming that NP is not contained in BPP. In addition, we adjust some simple and well-known algorithms for MaxCut to the fault tolerance setting. For MaxCut, we have the combinatorial half approximation that iteratively takes a vertex that has a crossing degree which is less than half of its degree and moves it to the other side of the cut. We present a purely combinatorial algorithm that achieves a half approximation as well for the adaptive adversary on unweighted graphs and a single fault. The classic algorithm of MaxCut fails, but we show that a local search that allows for a slightly richer family of local improvement steps suffices. Another well-known algorithm is the random half approximation that outputs a random cut. Surprisingly, we show that for weighted graphs, a random cut cannot achieve better than 1 over 4 approximation against the adaptive adversary and a single fault. For unweighted graphs with many vertices, we show that a random cut achieves a half minus epsilon approximation against the adaptive adversary and a single fault. For the oblivious adversary, a random cut achieves a half approximation for weighted graphs and many faults, even for a non-constant number of faults, and the analysis is much simpler. And now, for the most exciting part, the ideas and tools that we used. One main observation that we use is called greedy moves in stable cuts. For every k, we define a k-greedy move as taking a vertex v with a crossing degree that is lower than its degree minus k over 2, and moving it to the other side of the cut. Moving this vertex to the other side of the cut is helpful because of two reasons. First, it increases the size of the cut by at least k, and second, it doesn't decrease the KFT value against an adaptive adversary, which means that the size of the cut after the removal of the worst k vertices doesn't decrease. Now we can show that every optimal fault-tolerant max cut can be transformed into another optimal cut that satisfies that for every vertex v, its crossing degree is greater than half of its degree minus k over 2. We call this kind of cut a k-stable cut. And the good thing about having an optimal k-stable cut is that we can lower bound the size of the cut before the vertices are removed, which turns out to be very helpful. And now we are ready for the 0.878 approximation against the adaptive adversary. Our algorithm uses an algorithm for another problem, which is called simultaneous max cut. In the simultaneous max cut problem, we are given a vertex set V, tau-weighted graphs on the vertex set V, and thresholds C1 to C tau. The goal here is to find a cut that is large in all the given graphs. More precisely, we want to find the cut S, such that the size of S on the instance Gi is greater than Ci for every I. Here, we want to find the cut such that the size of the cut on G1 is at least C1, and the size of the cut on G2 is at least C2, and so on. And note that the cut is the same in all the instances. Of course, we aim to find such a cut only if such a cut exists. This problem is known to be a bit hard, but we know how to approximate it. Bangal et al. Showed a 0.878 approximation for simultaneous max cut for every constant number of instances. As a matter of fact, fault-tolerant max cut is a special case of simultaneous max cut, as we can see in the following example. Suppose that we have a graph, and we want to find the fault-tolerant max cut on this graph with a single fault. What we can do is to use simultaneous max cut. For every vertex, we create an instance that contains the graph after the vertex fails. Let's C be the optimal FT value of the graph, which means that given an optimal fault-tolerant max cut, after the adversary chooses a vertex to fail, the size of the cut is C. In other words, if we find a cut such that its size in all the instances is greater than C, then we have an optimal fault-tolerant max cut solution. And note that we don't know what C is, but since C is a non-negative integer that is bounded by M, we can do a binary search and find it. So this sounds great, but there is one problem. As I said before, we know how to approximate simultaneous max cut for a constant number of instances only. And in order to deal with k faults, we need n choose k instances. Therefore, this method isn't suffice, even not for a single fault. Hence, we cannot use simultaneous max cut straightforwardly, but we will do use it in a slightly different way. The idea is to identify a set of constant size, which we call the heavy set. The idea behind the heavy set is that it contains vertices that their failure affects the size of the cut dramatically. For example, we have this vertex here that has just one edge. Hence, we don't really care if the adversary removes this vertex, since in the worst case, we will lose one edge from the cut. Intuitively, vertices that interest us are vertices that have a large degree. The motivation is that if we have a cut that is good when heavy vertices fail, then the cut is good when non-heavy vertices fail as well. Then, assume we have such a heavy set, we can use simultaneous max cut as follows. We can look at the instances that corresponds to all the options of removing k heavy vertices, and since k is constant and the heavy set is of constant size, we have a constant number of instances. Now, we can find an alpha approximated simultaneous max cut on these instances and get a solution. We know that no matter which k heavy vertices fail, the size of the remaining cut is at least alpha c. And I recall that c is the optimal FT value that we find by a binary search. The question is what happens if the adversary removes non-heavy vertices as well. So let's take a look at a graph with some heavy set and k vertices that fail. First, we can remove the heavy vertices. Note that there are at most k heavy vertices that fail, thus it follows from the simultaneous max cut approximation that the size of the remaining cut is at least alpha c. Now, we can fail the non-heavy vertices. So let's assume that we know, and we don't know that yet, that the following condition holds, which means that the degree of every non-heavy vertex is at most epsilon over k multiplied by alpha c. Then, when we fail the non-heavy vertices, we have that the size of the cut is at least alpha c minus at most k non-heavy vertices multiplied by the largest degree that they may have, which is at least y minus 1 minus epsilon alpha c. And since C is the optimal value, then we get a 1 minus epsilon alpha approximation. Hence, our mission reduces to finding a set of constant size that satisfies the degree condition. And we show how to find such set, except for some types of graphs, for which we show how to find the solution in a different way. And this is how we do that. First, we order the vertices by degree, where V1 is the vertex with the largest degree, and Vn is the vertex with the smallest degree. Then, we initialize h to be the first k vertices, and iteratively add vertices to h according to their order. In addition, we have some variable sigma, which lower bound c, as I will explain later. For now, let's assume that sigma lower bounds c, and take a look at the condition of the while loop. We add vertices to h as long as the degree of the current vertex is greater than epsilon over k alpha sigma. Therefore, when the condition doesn't hold, it means that from now on, all the degrees are at most epsilon over k alpha sigma. Since sigma lower bound c, it means that the degree of every vertex that is not in h is at most epsilon over k alpha c, as we wanted. So, if the algorithm terminates because of the green condition, then we are done. And this is why sigma lower bound c. As I showed in the beginning of the lecture, we know that there exists a k-stable optimal solution for fault-tolerant maxcut, for which the cosine degree of every vertex is at least its degree minus k over 2. Then, after k vertices fail, we have that the cosine degree of every vertex that didn't fail is at least the original cosine degree minus k, which is at least its degree minus 3k over 2. In other words, every vertex that doesn't fail contributes to the cut at least dv minus 3k over 2, and this is the amount we add to sigma for every vertex that we add to h, while the over 4 instead of over 2 is to avoid double counting. And the reason that we first add k vertices to h and only then start updating sigma is because we want to lower bound the contribution after some k vertices fail. And these are the vertices with the largest guaranteed contribution, so we just don't count them. Note that for vertices that has degree that is smaller than 3k, the guaranteed contribution is 0. And this is the reason we don't add these vertices to h and quit the loop instead. So let's see what we have. We denote the maximal degree of vertices outside h by dmax. If dmax is greater than 3k, then the algorithm quits the loop because of the green condition, and h is a good heavy set, as we explained earlier. In addition, if dmax is at most 3k and c is greater than 3k squared over epsilon, then h is good as well, since when k light vertices fail, at most 3k square edges are removed, which is an epsilon fraction of the optimal value c. The case that is left is when dmax is at most 3k and c is at most 3k square over epsilon. In this case, we identify a set which we call the super heavy set that contains vertices that the adversary must fail if the solution is k-stable. These vertices are vertices that their guaranteed contribution is strictly greater than c, because if such vertex doesn't fail, it alone contributes for the cut more than c edges, which means that the size of the cut after failure is greater than c in contradiction. And from rearranging the equation, we get that the super heavy set consists of all the vertices that has a degree that is greater than 2c plus 3k. Which is constant because c is constant. If you want to deal with k faults and the size of the super heavy set is x, then we can remove the super heavy vertices from the graph and deal with k minus x faults instead. In the remaining graph, all the vertices have a constant degree, which makes our lives easier. If there are many edges, then we can show that an approximated max cut is a good fault tolerant max cut with respect to k minus x faults. And if there are no many edges, then what we can do is to brute force over the cuts of the non-isolated vertices and find an optimal solution. In the few minutes that we still have, I will present the general idea of the alpha GW approximation for the oblivious adversary. I remind you that this is the objective. we want to find a distribution that maximizes the FT value, which is the minimum expected size of the cut over all possible failures. Here, we use a linear programming, and this is the program that formulates our objective. For every cut, we have a variable, PS, which represents the probability of the cut to be sampled. And in addition, we have the variable Z, which represents the expected size that the adversary can remove from the graph. In this program, we have n plus 1 constraints, which is great, but we have an exponential number of variables, which is bad. Then we look at the dual program, which looks like this. Here, we have n plus 1 variables, y and xu for every vertex u, but we have an exponential number of constraints. Having an exponential number of constraints is not so good, but we can handle it using the ellipsoid method. The ellipsoid method was presented by Gretschel et al., and this is the idea. We have the ellipsoid algorithm and the separation oracle. Only the separation oracle knows the linear program, and he communicates with the ellipsoid algorithm. In each iteration, the algorithm sends to the oracle an assignment, and the oracle has to return one of the following. If the assignment is feasible, then he has to return feasible, and otherwise he has to return a violated constraint. Our mission is to implement the oracle. And note that going over the program and verify each constraint individually is not an option, since the oracle has to be efficient. However, we show that the oracle can be implemented using an approximation for maxcut. And since we use an approximated maxcut, the oracle might be mistaken. If the assignment is feasible, then he always right. But if the assignment is not feasible, he might say that the solution is feasible. However, in this case, we show that the assignment is almost feasible, which means that if we change the variable y to be y over alpha gw, then the assignment becomes feasible. And now we look at the new program, which is like the original dual program, but contains only constraints that the oracle sent to the ellipsoid algorithm while the execution. And note that the execution of the ellipsoid algorithm that communicates with an oracle that knows the original program is the same as it would communicate with an oracle that knows the new program. Therefore, the result of the executions will be the same. Finally, we look at the primal program that corresponds to the new dual. This program is similar to the original primal program, but with polynomial number of variables. It also has a polynomial number of constraints, thus we can solve it efficiently. We show that if the optimal solution for the original program is y star, then the optimal solution for the new program is at least alpha gw y star, meaning that we achieved an alpha gw approximation as we desired. So thank you for watching, and I hope to meet you in the online session.